Hello, I am Klaas and I will present part of the theory of module 3, which is about basic inferencing using RDF schema. And I will first discuss a short recap of the previous video lecture and then start discussing the syntax of RDF schema. So recall we had the schema and data level. So at the schema level we have generic concepts, and at the data level we have our actual instances. In this case, the Arc de Triomphe is classified as an arc. So Arc de Triomphe is an individual concept, and our knowledge graph denotes Arc de Triomphe. And then Arc de Triomphe has an actual place and location and a specific name. And then we can classify it as an arch, because structurally it is an arch. But it might also be, it's also a building, so we can classify it as multiple things. And using RDF schema, we can do this classification. So we make RDF schema is about defining your schema level, and thereby you can classify things and interrelate things. So there are several things we can do. We have several formulas. We can say that something can only be an instance of a class based on certain conditions. We can define relationships between classes and say that an instance is of a type of a certain class. We can have property characteristics. We can, for example, define subproperties and many more things. So RDF schema allows you to do part of these things, define part of these things. And then in later weeks, we will also use OWL, the web ontology language, which is even more expressive. So you have all these instances, these data points, basically. So you have countries and people and pictures of cities. So they all have some name or some year in which they were founded, or a birth year. And so this is all data. And then what we want to do is group them together as classes and group them together and classify them. So a city as something being a house, a country, a man, US presidents, male US presidents. So we have things that can belong to multiple instances. And then this is something we can do with RDF schema in part. So RDF schema, we define a class by saying that country is of type class. So then this country is now part of your schema level. And then we can have data, so instances, which we can also define using normal RDF, saying that that it belongs to this class. So we use RDF as class to denote that something is of a class. So you can both see it here in triple notation, and then also in a visualized knowledge graph, basically. So with the first triple, we say country is of type class, and then the second one says that an instance in your, so X is a shorthand, a prefix for example data set. So this is your data set, your local data set, and in that data set we defined, we have the instance Netherlands, and it belongs to X country, and country is then also part of your own data set. And RDFS is a reserved symbol, or it is a reserved denotation for defining a class. And RDF type also, so these we cannot use in our, these are not part of our example data set, but these are part of the RDF and RDFS language. So this is a RDF syntax for defining single classes. But if you have a very large domain, you might also want to define subclasses. So you have a hierarchy of classes. for example, like taxonomy. Like in the animal kingdom, you can say a dolphin is a subclass of mammal, and mammal is then a subclass of animal. And in this, so for the notation is RDFS subclass. So in this slide, we can see an example of the European country being a subclass of country. So then country in another triple beneath it is also defined as being a class. So to come back to our dolphin example, so dolphins would be a subclass of mammals, and then mammals would be the superclass of dolphins. And then a dolphin called Flipper would be an instance of class dolphin, because it's a real living animal living in some sea park. In the example in the slide, so European country, we could say that the Netherlands is an instance of European country. So this is at the data level, and then European country is a class at the schema level, and we use RDF schema or RDFS to define this as a subclass of country, and also we use RDFS to define country as being a class. So you have super and subclasses, and then the nice thing is that subclasses inherit the properties of their superclasses. For example, a dolphin is a mammal, and so it's an animal, and a mammal and dolphin itself can also be a class. And then Flipper is an instance. So then a dolphin named Flipper will inherit properties from its superclass mammal. So Flipper is both a dolphin and a mammal. And because it's a mammal, it'll inherit the property that it carries babies in its womb, because that is the specific characteristic of being a mammal. So you could also say a sheep is a mammal or a cow is a mammal. So they all might have different classes, but they inherit carrying babies from the superclass mammal. Similarly, a sailing ship, a ship with a sail is a subclass of a boat. So you also have boats that do not have sails. But all subclasses of boat have in common that they can move through the water. And then a sailing ship has some more specific properties, that it has a sail, for example, and it uses wind to move, whereas a mammoth tanker would use an engine to move. So using these super subclass properties, we can define a domain in great detail, and we can use inheritance of superclasses to make life easier. And as you might have noticed, the European country class is is not exactly well modeled in maybe all cases. So from the picture or from the definition, we could say that the Netherlands is an instance of the class European country. However, we could also instantiate Europe as being an instance of class continent. So then Europe becomes becomes part of the data level, because Europe has a location and might have the year of discovery or some geographical coordinates. So you could also say, well, Europe is an instance, basically. So we could also, or maybe we should model it as an instance. So it really depends on what level of detail you need for your data. So in different cases, you might want to define Europe as an instance of continent, and then maybe say a country has a property located on a continent, which connects a country to the continent it's located on. So we'll get into more detail later on about how to model classes, or whether we should model a certain thing as a class or an instance. So So we'll have a methodology to do this. So then there is also some RDF schema syntax for making properties more meaningful. So for certain properties, we can define a domain and a range. And this is a bit more tricky. So this is a restriction of where a property can exist. So we say, in this example, we say that contain city, this property, this predicate or semantic relationship, if you will. So this can only happen between a country and a city. So we can only relate a country, we can only use contain city if it originates, so the domain, if it originates from a certain country, and if its target or its range is a city. So we cannot say that a dolphin contains a city or a boat contains a city. So this is restrictive. And later on we'll talk about these RDF schema being applied in reasoners, and then you might get a warning or an error that a property in which a domain and range restriction applies then is not valid when you define it for a certain class. So then you get a your reasoner will show that a dolphin cannot contain a city, for example. Maybe to make it a bit more explicit even, is that we define contain city between country and city. So then each instance of a country, so this relationship contain city can only be used by instances of a country, and then its target of this relationship can only be a city. So contain city can only be used by, for example, the Netherlands contain city Amsterdam. And so this is restrictive. Now, so when doing these, applying these rules yourself or doing domain modeling, then you might want to say that the province contains a city, but according to this definition, that is not possible. So unless you make some more rules. So to inherit these domain and range restrictions, which apply to a property, to the property contains city, we can say, similar to subclasses, we can define subproperties. In this case, in this example, we say that has capital is a subproperty of contains city. So next to a country containing a city, one of these cities might also be the capital of the country. So this is more specific because not all cities in a country are a capital. Therefore, it's a subclass. But has capital, so for example, the Netherlands has capital Amsterdam. The has capital property will still inherit the domain country and the range city. So has capital can only occur between a country and a city. So this is useful because you can, because of this inheritance between superclass contains city, superproperty contains city, and subproperty has capital, we can reuse domain and range restrictions and other properties. And we can use a reasoner, which we'll discuss also later, to infer that, for example, if we have data, several instances that say the Netherlands has capital Amsterdam, that this also means because has capital is a subproperty of contains city, that the Netherlands will also have, the Netherlands also contains city Amsterdam, because Amsterdam is the capital of the Netherlands. Amsterdam is also contained in the Netherlands. So this is what we can define then, and we can infer it. So we don't even have to specify that the Netherlands contains the city Amsterdam. Once we know that the Netherlands has capital Amsterdam, then the reasoner will infer that Amsterdam, that the Netherlands contains Amsterdam. And then we do not inherit, well, we inherit the range city from contain city, but has capital can then also again define its own range that it must apply to some instances of a class capital. So has capital can only has a star target a capital. All right, so these are the RDF schema syntax rules that we will work with. So to give you an overview of all the different rules that we discussed, we have RDFS statements with which we can infer class membership, sub and superclass inheritance, also inheritance of super properties in the contained city and has capital example. And with domain and range, the domain and range of properties, or basically of the predicates in your triple, or the semantic relationships, we can also infer class membership. And we can have property inheritance using the subproperty relationship. So there's lots of notations in this overview. We have X, X colon country, RDF type, RDFS class, RDFS subclass of. Now my question to you is, what are the reserved symbols in all these statements? I have a graphical overview here, so you can take a look and check what symbols we need. What symbols we cannot overwrite, or so you probably guess that everything with RDF and RDFS class is a RDFS is a reserved symbol in this case. So X is our own data set, and then the reserved symbols, they are defined by the World Wide Web Consortium in the RDF and RDFS specification. So they are reserved for us to use as formulas on our data. In previous weeks, we also discussed the entailment rules. So any idea how these entailment rules, how they apply to RDF schema? So we have lots of notations in RDF and RDFS. And then we need to define some entailment rules to make sure that these basically these formulas they work out as we intend them. So we must say that if something is a subclass, it'll inherit properties. If there is a domain and a range, we must say that any instance of a certain class can use a certain relationship only to a certain target. So in terms of entailment rules, we first define what can be the subject, predicate, and object place in each triple. So in the first entailment rule, we first say that the subject must always be of type resource. A predicate must also always be of type RDFS, RDF property. And then an object can either be another resource, so for example, Amsterdam, or it can be, or its name. So it should be a resource, and then it can also be a literal. So its name is a literal, or the number of inhabitants is a literal, and then the resource is a something you can you can point to using a URI. So then we have these nodes. So the resources are basically nodes: Amsterdam and the Netherlands. And instead of a node, we can also say that it has some surface area, or it has a name. And these are literals of type integer or string. So then the next entailment rule defines that if we use RDF type in the predicate location, then the object must refer to a class. So we cannot say that some subject is of RDF type literal. So RDF type would refer to a class. And then in the third rule, we say if something is a class, then it's also a subclass of itself, which might seem like a strange rule, but this is then used in the reasoner to derive other rules. So we or infer. So we infer a lot of things, but not all things might seem intuitive or useful. But either something is used to derive other or to infer other facts, or in some very special cases, this might also be useful. Then the same goes for the fourth rule, which basically says the same, that if some predicate is a property, then it's a subproperty of itself. So then for the next set of properties, we have 10 in nine in total. We first define that subclass of and subproperty of is a transitive thing. So if S is a subclass of Y and Y is a subclass of Z, then that must entail that S is also a subclass of Z by transitivity. And the same goes for properties. So if P is a subproperty of Q and Q is a subproperty of R, then P is a subproperty of R. So the next three rules, 7, 8, and 9, are where it gets interesting, because we can infer new knowledge that's not defined by hand, but that is inferred from the RDFS statements that we made. So in 7, we say that if S has some predicate, if S has some relationship with O, there is some property between them, then and if P is a subproperty of Q, then we know that because P is a subproperty of Q, then Q also holds between S and O. So we infer that because there is a subproperty P between S and O, then its superproperty Q must also exist between S and O. So we can infer this this triple SQO because Q is a superproperty of P. So this is a form of inheritance. Basically, we say that because P is a subproperty, then its superproperty must also hold. So for example, the Netherlands contains the Netherlands has capital Amsterdam, and if we know that has capital is a subproperty of contained city, then we also know that the Netherlands contains city Amsterdam, which is of course logical to us, but it might not be intuitive to other people. And it also is something that is automatically inferred. So then you can basically automatically derive new knowledge. And this is a simple example, but there might be examples that require very specific domain knowledge. And that is where then these statements come in handy, because it also tells you something about, it tells you a lot about the meaning of data. And then in rule 8 and rule 9, we use the domain and range restrictions to infer class membership. So again, we infer new knowledge. So for example, if we say that there is some relationship between S and O, so subject predicate object, and this this predicate or this property has a domain defined being X, then this S must belong to class X, and the same with range. So domain is the origin and range is the target. So if there is a subject predicate object where the predicate has range X, then the object, so the target of P, must belong to class X. So we infer class membership by saying this this property or this semantic relationship can only be hold between two specific classes. All right, so now we have defined several examples of using RDF schema, and we have the entailment rules. So if we have this knowledge graph, we can use a reasoner to infer knowledge based on the RDF schema definitions that we made. So when we apply the reasoner, there are various things that are inferred. Certain inferences are very intuitive or not very useful, you might say, but then certain things are quite useful. And they, for example, in this case, make sure that you you do not forget to define anything, that you forget to define, for example, that the Netherlands contains city Amsterdam. So this is at the data level. We have defined the Netherlands as an instance of class European country, and we have defined Amsterdam as an instance. We haven't defined Amsterdam as being an instance of capital, but we infer that Amsterdam is of type capital because there is the has capital relationship that points to Amsterdam, and at our schema level we have defined that contain city as domain country and range city. So here we have the Netherlands, which is a country, and so that the range is correct, and then it has range city, you see, and then because we know that because the range is city, Amsterdam must also be a city, and the has capital is a subproperty of contain city, and it has its own range. So then we know it is also of type capital, and we haven't even defined capital and city, capital being a subclass of city, but it's already inferred by the subproperty relationship. So Amsterdam is both a capital and a city because the subproperty has capital inherits from contain city that the target must also be a city. So Amsterdam is both a city and a capital. And because has capital is a subproperty of contain city, then the relationship contain city also holds between the Netherlands and Amsterdam. So we have derived several facts, several statements, several triples that were not explicit in our dataset yet. So we only defined instance the Netherlands to have relationship has capital to target Amsterdam, but because of all the domain and range and subproperty and superproperty and subclass and superclass statements in RDFS, we can derive several triples that were not explicit yet. Some inferences are still missing. So the reasoner would use the first few rules to say, for example, that a class is also a subclass of itself. But this is mostly used for internal reasoning, so they are omitted here. But if you use a reasoner, you can still see these inferences. And in some cases, they might even be useful. So all these inferences, they are made based on the reserved symbols. So the RDFS domain and the RDF type, RDFS class. And this basically means that we do not need to know the names of the user-defined classes. So these are all classes that we defined in our example data set. So if you look back, we have X European country, X country, X Netherlands. but for inferencing, we do not need to know what these what the names are and what they mean. The reasoner just applies the rules based on the RDF schema syntax and the entailment rules. And then I already shortly mentioned that we have the data level and the schema level, and this is defined together in one file or in one triple store. So the X the Netherlands is an instance of a European country, but we define it together with saying that a European country is a subclass of another country. So the schema and the data level are intertwined. And we really have to keep track of what are instances and what are schema or classes and properties when you do the assignments, for example. And you see also that the inferences are applied to both the data level and the class level. So we can reason at the conceptual level and also at the data level to infer new knowledge and infer new new properties and inheritance of properties. So in summary, we defined classes and properties, subproperties in using RDF schema in RDFS. One thing to note, to observe, is that properties are just as important as classes. So we say they are first class citizens because they're equally important to classes. For example, in UML or object-oriented programming, properties are defined inside classes. And so the way of inheriting is a bit different. So we can't have we can't define subproperties and domain and range in that sense. So this is more more detailed in how you define your domain. Then we have domain and range restrictions for properties, and they are tricky, as we already mentioned, that they restrict between which classes a certain property can exist, and then you might get errors or you might miss certain data because according to the domain and range statements restrictions, a certain relationship cannot exist, so it will not show up because the reasoner will take it away. So it infers new knowledge, but it also removes knowledge if a certain thing does not hold according to the domain and range restrictions. Previous slide, we also discussed that you can have the data and schema level interchangeable. So, for example, we have several triples that say that the Airbus A380 is a plane model, the A320 as well. And then the A380 is a subclass of an Airbus plane. And then an instance, you can just as easily define an instance in the same file or in the same triple store. RDFS cannot define that something is not true, so no negation yet. And then later in AL, we can do this a bit better. Also later in AL, we'll have notions of equality between classes. So RDF schema is still a bit restrictive. Later we'll use AL to have even more rules and a better specification of a certain domain. And then there are some additional things that are useful when you you define schemas and data with RDFS. So a human readable label is useful. For example, the country. Country is, of course, an English name. And we can say country is a class, but then as a label, we can say in Dutch language, it's called land, or in German, it's called land. And in other languages, it's called something different. So then we can also use for a web application, we can say I only want RDFS labels in a certain language. So NL is the language code. So for German, you would use @DE. Commenting on a resource is also useful, especially if you build an ontology or you build a you have all these RDF statements. You can also use RDFS comment to explain what they mean and what you intend. So RDFS comma Amsterdam has two good universities. We can then also have this comment next to a class that has a rule that it says it can only have two good universities. Later on in ALF, for example, when we have more advanced rules. And then there's the C also. So if you have two data sets, example data set Amsterdam and DBpedia Amsterdam, then you can say that these resources are the same. So they are located in different data sets, but they refer to the same thing, to the same instance. So that's all nice. So RDF schema allows you to do a lot of things, but then we are still missing several things to properly define a domain. One of these is the classification of instances. So we have cities, houses, countries. But we want to have more rules to infer class membership. So with RDFS, we can maybe infer class membership based on subproperty relationships and domain and range. But we might also want to say that if somebody is the president of some country, and that person is male or female, then that person also belongs to class US male president or US female president. And then later on in OWL we can have rules to do this. Alright, in summary, we have RDF schema. It is useful because we can have very formal semantics. Now in terms of meaning, think of hyperlinks. So a hyperlink, the meaning of a hyperlink is basically see here or see also. Whereas with RDF and RDF schema, we can have a very specific name for a property. So contains city or has capital. And then we can even have metadata on that property to say this property connects a country to its capital under these conditions and have domain and range restrictions for relationships. So they are hyperlinks with very explicit meaning. So we have a distinction between classes, properties and instances. So classes and properties are at the schema level, and RDFS or RDF schema defines your schema, but then the rules and the formulas you use are also are applied both at the schema and the data level, so to classes, properties, and the instances of classes and properties. We have a set of reserved symbols in RDF schema, and then entailment rules that use these reserved symbols to calculate. And then we say this calculation is called inferencing. So we inferencing is applying entailment rules to formulas, to the RDF schema formulas to produce new facts. So we can infer class membership, and we can infer that there is a relationship between two instances because the subproperty is used, and then the superproperty must also hold. But still, we cannot do everything. So inferring class membership can be based on many more things, and then later on we discuss OWL, the web ontology language, in which we can have more expressive semantics and have more advanced reasoning and inferencing. All right, many thanks for watching. If you have any questions, please go to the Q&A sessions, the practicals. First, go to Piazza for any questions, especially about the practical assignments. Thanks for your attention and see you around.